Welcome to Contagious Influencers of America. This is Tim Storey, life coach to the stars, with the David Sams. David, wow, wow, wow. A lot of people are listening to the podcast. Their lives are being changed. We're hearing from them. Why do you love doing this podcast so much?
I love doing the podcast because it is real. It's raw. I go into my vulnerable side,
yes,
which I usually don't do. The real reason I love it is, you know, with traditional media, with traditional radio, mm-hmm. there's all these rules.
Yes.
You know, you got to go by the clock. You got to do what the program director says. There's this whole rule book that you have in radio that you don't have with podcasts. The other really cool thing with the podcast is that if you're listening to this right now, it's because you're really, truly interested in the content.
Yes.
It's not just because you stumbled across us on a radio dial or because you're hearing us between a couple of songs you like. But if you're listening to CIA, Contagious Influences of America right now, you're getting inspired by this. You're getting new information by this. You look forward to each and every episode.
Yes.
And some are better than others, but, you know, we go for a grand slam on every one of them. We are getting some tremendous guests, I will say that much.
Some of the best. And I want to just commend you on that, because for those that are just coming into the world of David Sams, of what you've done in the past with the Oprah Winfrey Show, working with the King Brothers, Jeopardy, Wheel of Fortune, all the other shows you've produced, directed, been in the business for all these years. Thank you for taking the time to book some of the best guests of any shows that I'm on, booking great guests like you are, and taking the time to highlight some great things like we're highlighting today. Let's talk about a movie that is really, really about to change people's lives.
Well, this movie stars someone who I just admire so very much, Sarah Drew. Sarah, of course, was an actress on Grey's Anatomy for many, many years. This is her first big project since she left that show. It's called Indivisible. And it is an amazing story because it really goes into the story of a serviceman, a chaplain, his family, and how he fights those battles, not only on the battlefield, yeah. but in his mind and his heart, because he feels so much for those men and women that he's out there in Iraq fighting for our country for and shepherding them.
Yes.
That to some extent, he forgets about his own family and their needs.
As a life coach, can I tell you what I pick up from this movie? Is the word torn. For your life, for my life, for anybody that's listening, we are torn between all these responsibilities that we have. So for a mother that's listening right now, if she has, let's say, three children, she has responsibility to the children. If you're married, then now you got a husband. You might have a job. You're doing your job. You may be volunteering somewhere. You know what's happening, David? You're being torn.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But this is the challenge of being torn at the highest level.
Mm.
Again, so many of you are listening today and you are torn between these things. We're going to give some answers. Are we going to dive into your life a little later?
Yeah, absolutely. After we do this interview with Sarah Drew, you're going to be surprised on this interview. You read about these stars and these big primetime actors and the tabloids and in the trades and so forth, but you never go under the hood like we're about to do with Sarah Drew. So you ready to do that?
I'm excited. Let's do it. Let's find out more and see how this movie is changing lives.
Your son is what, three?
Six.
Six?
My daughter's three.
Your daughter's mm-hmm. three. Oh yeah. My gosh.
We actually just today had his graduation.
In the blink of an eye, isn't it just amazing how you wake up and there they are?
Yeah, just full, big, little humans. I mean, it's crazy how much they grow and how fast they grow and how hilarious and interesting and, you know, incredibly frustrating at times they can be. But they are really becoming their own little people, and it's really cool to see.
Are they close?
Oh, yes. Very close. And they're also at each other's throats, but for the most part, they play extremely well together. They're just the best of friends.
I think the last time I saw you, you were doing Mom's Night Out. Was that like 4 or 5 years ago, right?
Yeah. Well, I shot that movie when Micah was 18 months old. And then I was promoting it actually when I was 6 weeks pregnant with Hannah. So I had both of them kind of in the midst of that project in a really big way.
So when you did Mom's Night Out, it was a concept, right? I mean, you were only a mom for like a year and a half, right? Uh-huh. But now that you've been a mom for several years, there's probably more that goes into that whole idea of Mom's Night Out than there was 5 years ago.
Oh, for sure. You know, I think when you're in the early stage of motherhood, their first birthday is really more a celebration for you, having like weathered it, like lived through the sleepless nights and the sleep training and the crazy, just all of the craziness that goes into the first year of being a parent, and all the like fear and worry and the stuff that you, especially as a new parent, you have nothing to compare it to. So everything is kind of terrifying. So you really do celebrate that first year and things, it kind of ebbs and flows. Like things get easier. Some things get easier, but then other things get much more complicated. Like my son is incredibly articulate. And so he can turn our conversation on its head, you know, and where we do this kind of therapeutic speech where we'll say, when you did this thing, it made me feel this way. Well, the other day he broke a glass by throwing a pillow over and over again after we told him not to do it over and over again. And he broke it and we were like, Micah. And he burst into tears and he goes, when you yell at me, it makes me feel like you care more about the glass than me. You know, we're like, oh my gosh, this is not something I had to deal with when you were 18 months old.
Right.
But you're just so smart. And yeah, there's a whole new set of challenges and it's all beautiful and exciting.
I have two girls, right? Mm-hmm. And they're a couple of years apart. And I think of these trips to Disneyland when they were like literally, you know, a few months out of the hospital, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, and now you look back and go, what was I thinking?
Why did I go there? We just got back from a full week at Disney World in Florida. Like we did 5 straight days of 11 hours in the park. Go, 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 go. But what's great about doing it at this age versus this super young baby time, because it's really a vacation for the kids. It's not, I mean, Disney World is magical in its own way for adults, but it's really for the kids. But the really cool thing about going when they're older is my kids were playing Disney World for weeks leading up to the trip. Like they were building rides out of couch pillows and announcing what they were doing and pretending to ride on roller coasters. And oh my gosh, the experience was so much more extravagant for them and exciting for them. It was awesome.
Now, I'm sure you read What to Expect When You're Expecting, right?
I actually read no books.
No. Are you kidding?
I read not a single... Oh, no. The only book I read was by Dr. Bloomberg, and it was Healthy Sleep Habits, Happy Child, which was an incredibly important sleep training book for me, anyway.
That's the equivalent to, happy wife, happy life.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, sleep train those nuggets.
What advice, what could you share with some young mom right now who is, let's rewind back 5-6 years to where you were, to what you have learned today. What would be the one thing that you wish you would have known then that you know now?
I think I would have given myself a break. I would tell a young mom, first of all, trust your gut. If you love your child, you're doing a great job, you know? And we can get so caught up as moms in what's the right way to do something, or I'm failing at this, or I'm not doing this right, or I'm not doing enough of this or that or the other thing. And we really have to just give ourselves a break and breathe. And I would also tell young moms that self-care is probably the most important thing to being a present and energetic and alive mom, spiritually alive mom. You have to take time for yourself. And that's it's still hard for me to do that there because I also work. And so if I'm not physically required to be somewhere for work, it's hard for me to choose to take an hour or two to go have lunch with a friend who's like really life-giving in my life, or to go have a massage or whatever. But doing that stuff is exactly what my heart needs to recharge and then show up in a much more present way for my kids. So I would say give yourselves a break, invest in self-care, and remember that your gut, you are that kid's child, and you need to trust your gut. That's.
And I think that's also going to help your relationship.
Of course it will. It helps everything.
Yeah, yeah.
It helps everything if you're taking care of yourself. It's that whole thing about put your own oxygen mask on before you put the mask on the child. Like, mm-hmm. You have to be breathing oxygen before you're able to care for an irrational little creature that might throw a fit at any second, and you got to keep your wits about you and stay patient and be loving in the midst of it. You know, you gotta be breathing oxygen before you handle that.
Yeah,
you know?
Absolutely. Yeah.
So yeah.
That reminds me of I flew out here on a Southwest flight about 3 days ago, and I was sitting in the exit row. I always get that wonderful seat, that
yes.
one seat on Southwest. I noticed this young lady coming in, and she looked terrified. I could just see it on her face, right? So, you know, and they're saying, hey, you better sit down. All the seats are filling up, right? She looked over at me. I looked at her, and I waved her over, and I said, hey, sit down. This is a premium seat. And she sat down next to me. She then told me that this is her first flight.
Wow.
And she told me that she was 17, and she has a three-year-old at home that her husband's watching, right? I said, well, I want you to know I'm here for you, but you're sitting in the exit row, so if the plane goes down.
Oh, come on. No.
I said, we're responsible for opening the door and saving lives.
No pressure.
So the oxygen mask thing.
Yes.
I said, now this thing's going to come down, blah, blah, blah. You got to put it on first. I said, if you have your baby, you couldn't be sitting here in the seat. But I said, since you aren't, you have to, you know, put this thing on first. And I explained to her how this all works with the baby. If she did have the baby, that she has to put the thing on first. And oh my gosh, her eyes just they were so big. It was so unbelievable. But you know what? That was the most unbelievable flight I've ever had in my life. I get to be a dad again.
Yeah.
Yeah, I got to be a dad again. I mean, it was so cool. I got to look out the window with this girl and say, and she had never been up 35,000 feet.
Uh-huh.
It was unbelievable.
That's an exciting thing to get to witness someone experiencing that for the first time.
You know, it is with the kids too when they're this age. I just remember my daughters growing up. My favorite picture is of the two of them kind of wrestling out on the front lawn, and they were probably 4 and 2.
Yeah.
And I look at that picture every day. It's sitting on my desk. And that whole scene just comes back alive for me, you know?
Well, they're so alive right now.
Yeah.
They don't have anything they need to be worrying about. They're so curious. They're so creative.
Mm-hmm.
My daughter walks around the house singing. She makes up songs just out of nowhere. Lyrics, they are usually accompanied with dance moves. And she's just in this other universe. Really, the most random things come out of her mouth when we're in the middle of a conversation about something else. She'll say, well, you know, actually, and then say a sentence that has nothing to do with anything we're talking about. And meanwhile, my son is very industrious and is always building something, always creating something, something that has bits and pieces that move or do something. And then he explains exactly how it is. And then when a conversation is happening, he's not looking at us, but his ears are glued to what's happening, and he'll immediately, you think that you're having a private conversation, he'll be like, oh yeah, why did you say that, you know? So it's so funny to you know, sense how completely different these two kids are, but how, you know, what they really make you slow down when you get completely wrapped up in career stuff or life stress or whatever it is that's thrown at you in the world. If you just slow down and just lock in to what their little minds and little creative spirits are doing, it has a way of just slowing your heart rate and bringing you into a place of peace and wonder, really. Like, that's the thing that's so beautiful about this age especially, is just there's so much wonder.
So did I hear that you just said that you sometimes stress out?
No, I don't stress out. Yes, I do stress out. I worry. I worry like I think probably most people do. And it's I've always battled with some anxiety. The industry that I work in can be a very, very stressful place, very uncertain, very much looking out into the wide open and wondering what's the next thing going to be. And, will I be, you know, will I stay on this gig or you know, it's a very, it can be very, very stressful. Even when you have a steady gig, it can still be stressful.
Well, you just went through that with Grey's Anatomy. You were on that show for 8-9 years, mm-hmm. and then you're not.
Yeah.
And what was it like to, I mean, I'm sure that, you know, I was in the TV business for 28 years and, you know, so I know the feeling of
right.
what you go through, right?
Yeah.
And we can all say, oh, yeah, you know, no big deal. But it is a big deal.
Oh, yeah.
It is a big deal
to wake
up and all of a sudden your life's changed.
Yeah.
Right?
Absolutely. I think, you know, I went through, it was sort of my biggest heartbreak in my career thus far, just because that community really felt like my family. And after being there for 9 years, you kind of feel like, well, of course I'll be there to the end. I'm an established part of this community. So it was a pretty big shock to be asked to be let go, for sure. It was a big shock. And then I also found myself going
But you didn't
through,
go down in a plane crash.
No, and I didn't get hit by a truck, so that's great. I think it was what I keep going back to is those 2 months were a crazy whirlwind, because I was let go and literally exactly 1 week later I was shooting a pilot. and then came back and finished the show, and it was a just crazy whirlwind. But what my takeaway has been the whole way through is like the tremendous joy in the midst of the sorrow, and because there was real grief in feeling hurt that I'd been let go, and there was real grief in saying goodbye not only to my character who I'd was so invested in and have spent a great deal of time and energy developing, you know, for 9 years. She's so much a part of me. So saying goodbye to her, saying goodbye to that community who I just love and adore. And then also just the stressor of saying goodbye to a steady gig and being like, mm-hmm. I'm now walking out into the wide open and I don't know what the next thing is going to be. There was real grief, like real grief. I felt a lot of grief and I went through a lot of stages of grief. But I was also so profoundly loved through it, not only by what I believe was like the biggest God hug ever, which was this incredible opportunity to jump into a new role immediately. And I always said in the midst of that it didn't matter if it went or not. I mean, I would have loved for it to go, but the gift was just in recognizing that people were taking an interest and wanted to bring me into something else. It made me feel like God was saying, I got you. Mm-hmm. You're going to be totally fine. I know this is sad, but I have you. And that's the lesson. But on top of that, I was so loved and so cared for by my crew and my cast and my close community and my friends and my family. My husband was so amazing. There was this rallying around both me and Jessica that was
Jessica
Capshaw, who also was
left,
like, yeah, that I think was it was almost too, it was so bright, the light was so bright it was almost hard to look at. That's how tangible the love was, with just cast members not wanting us to go and rallying and fans going out of their minds, and you know, so I wouldn't trade any of it. I really wouldn't trade any of it. It was such an extraordinary experience of being loved in the midst of pain.
Plus, you know, the way this song goes, and I Hope You Dance, is when one door closes, another door opens.
Yeah.
You know, I know for myself, as much as I am very forward thinking, you do have a tendency, or I have a tendency to, I think we all do to some extent, to get in our comfort zone.
Oh, yeah.
You know, it's really easy
yeah.
to do that.
Oh, yeah.
It's sort of like being a little bird in a bird's nest. Mom's mm-hmm. got to push you out.
Yeah.
Sometimes I think God's looking out for us and saying, you know what? I didn't really mean for you to be on Grey's Anatomy for 47 years.
Yeah, right. Yeah, and you know what? Because it was such an amazing job, it would have been hard for me to walk away on my own. Mm-hmm. It really would have been, because it was such a great gig, and it still is for everyone who's still there. But it's exciting. It's exciting to be in the space that I'm in right now. I'm meeting with people all over town right now. I'm reading tons of new material, and being in the position for the first time in 9 years to have the great wide open in front of me to, you know, create something myself or produce or dive more into directing or go more into film or go into another TV gig. It's just everything is wide open. And that is, I was scared, but now I'm excited.
Yeah.
There's been a shift, you know, through this whole process, but I am 100% excited and really eternally grateful for the experience that I had on that show, because it gave me so much.
So what were you like as a kid?
I was super dramatic, very feisty. I didn't let people push me around, and I sometimes got in trouble for that.
Mm-hmm. Give me one time.
Well,
come on, give,
yeah,
me,
no,
give,
I'll
give t- me a good
I'll
one.
I'll tell you, I was standing in line with some boy who was kind of a bully, who was always very unkind to me. I think I was in fifth grade or something, and I was in line, and he came and cut in kind of right behind me, and I was like, oh, hi, are you guys best friends? He was sitting there talking to, I guess, another friend of mine. And he looked at me and he goes, do you, like, have any friends or anything? And I literally backhanded him in the face. And he had braces and his lips started bleeding a little.
Oh, no.
Oh, my gosh. And he was just like, oh, you're so... He called me a bad name. And he never bothered me again.
Wow.
So, yeah, I had a tendency to lash out and had to learn how to control my emotions. Mm-hmm. I've always been a very sensitive kid and very frustrated with injustice.
Now you know where your son gets it.
I know. This is very true. This is very true. So yeah, I'm proud to say that I didn't hit very many people beyond elementary school, but I got in trouble a lot for lashing out physically in elementary school because I just wouldn't be bullied. I wouldn't.
So when did you start acting?
Since before I can remember. I was, my parents talk about my graduation from kindergarten, and I was just standing up there, and I went to a little Christian school, and I had this line, be still and know that I am God. And I had this poise and was just so present, and all the other kids were like staring at their feet and shoes, and my parents looked at each other and went, oh my gosh, what is this? And from that moment on, I mean, I was writing songs and performing them and selling tickets for my parents and my family from the earliest memories that I have of just, I have a journal of, like, as soon as I could write, I was like writing songs. And I even wrote a musical with my best friend when I was 11.
So was this a tug of war between singing and acting?
Oh yeah, but it was always together. It was always like, I mean, I did choirs and I did everything, and I thought about pursuing musical theater, but I did a program my summer between second and third year of college in New York City just to see if that was something viable for me, if I was strong enough in that area, and realized it was a very, very valuable program because a casting director saw me do a monologue, and that's what launched my entire career, was that program.
What program was that?
Cap 21 at NYU. But I did discover doing that program that was not for me. Musical theater was not where I would make my bread and butter, that I was a much stronger actor than a singer or dancer. So, and I didn't have the desire to train in the way that I would need to train to get up to that level. But doing that monologue for that casting director brought me my first professional gig, which was playing Juliet in a production of Romeo and Juliet outside of New York City at the McCarter Theater. And that was reviewed by the New York Times and Variety. And then I got my pick of agencies, and then I was off and running.
Romeo and Juliet, that's a pretty good consolation prize.
Yeah, exactly. Well, you shouldn't be doing musical theater, but you want to play Juliet? Yeah, it was a pretty great consolation prize. But yeah, I was always doing musical theater and plays in every anywhere I could, community theater, a couple little professional things in high school and stuff. But it's, yeah, always what I've wanted to do.
What was your favorite role back then?
Juliet.
No.
Oh, like before? Yeah. In high school, I played Louisa in The Fantastics.
Oh, wow.
Which, that was pretty amazing. That was my magical. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was my magical experience.
Very cool. I know my daughter, who's now going to Berklee College of Music there in Boston.
Yeah, yeah.
I would take her every year to New York for about 5 days, and we'd cram in as many shows as we could see. Mm-hmm. You know, it's something we could do together.
Yeah.
We saw Pippin, which
yeah,
I saw like 30
Pippin.
Years ago, right?
Oh, I love
I saw
Pippin.
The original.
Yeah.
So I took her to Pippin, and she fell in love with it. And so I said, you have to convince your school to do Pippin. And she came back. She went to Oaks Christian in Westlake. And she came back and convinced them, and she got to play the leading player.
Oh, that's amazing.
Right?
Yeah.
It was so cool to see her on stage
great.
Like a year later. And,
doing
of course,
it.
They go all out on the production. It was so just cool to see that. It shows you the kind of influence that you can have, the kind of impact that theater can have on an individual when they're young.
Oh, absolutely. I only listened to Broadway show tunes growing mm-hmm. up. I didn't mm-hmm. listen. There was classical music playing in my house. That's what my dad played all the time, which I loved and had like an affinity for. My brother was listening to like Smashing Pumpkins and REM and Live. And I was like, I don't care about that music because it doesn't have a story that mm-hmm. goes from this song to this song to this song to this song. I want to hear a story.
Mm-hmm.
Even though now I look at music, I'm like, each song is its own kind of tight story in and of itself. But for me, in that stage of my life, like I remember very specifically when I was 10, doing all kinds of mother's helping and chores around the house to earn enough money to buy a boombox, which cost $30, and then earned the $10 that I needed to buy the soundtrack to Les Mis. And that was my first ever big purchase that I had earned the money for and done chores and worked hard to earn. And I wore that cassette tape out. I was so in love with musical theater.
Guess what I get to play in high school? And I was the shyest kid. I was the shyest overweight kid you can imagine, right?
So what'd you play?
I got to play Sky Masterson in Guys and Dolls.
Oh, no way. That's amazing.
Which meant I get to kiss the girl.
Yeah, you do.
I think it was the first time I kissed a girl,
right.
Actually. You're right. On stage.
Oh, my first kiss was on stage, for sure. Yeah. I mean, isn't that so weird? It's the weirdest thing.
Yeah.
That is the weirdest thing. Yeah. And I remember, like you said, you took your daughters. Like, that was something that I did with my dad, too. He would take me. I remember him taking me into New York to see Once Upon a Mattress with Sarah Jessica Parker.
Wow.
And like, oh my gosh, it was so magical. I remember where we were sitting in the theater. And then my whole family would go in a lot and we would do standing room only. So we saw like Les Mis and Phantom of the Opera, and we saw The Lion King standing room. We just sat there with our heads on our, you know, on the little ledge watching from the back of orchestra.
Wow. That's fantastic. That's wonderful. Let's talk about your movie, Indivisible.
Yeah.
First of all, I noticed that you're also one of the executive producers.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
So, wow, you're getting, now you're moving up in the world.
Or just branching out, I guess, you know. I was super excited. I met Darren Moorman, who's the producer on the film, pitching him a book that I had optioned that I wanted to turn into a film. And it was my first sort of venture into potential producing. And he was like, that's such a great story, but I have one in my hands with financing ready to go that I think you'd be perfect for. Will you read the script? And I read the script, and I really resonated with the story. And I said, I would love to do this, Ken, but I want to come on as an executive producer. I want to learn the ropes. I want to be involved in the casting. I want to do script notes. I want to be involved in watching every frame with headphones on behind the camera anytime I'm not in front of the camera.
Mm-hmm.
I want to be involved in the post. Like, I just want to dive in. And they said yes. So they brought me on to this great project, and it was a really tremendous experience. So much fun.
So you really played more of a hands-on role
versus
she's only going to do it if she gets a producer credit.
Yeah, it wasn't about the credit. It wasn't about the credit for me.
Well, that's
it was
good.
Very much about shaping the narrative, shaping the story. I care very much about quality. And so that's, you know, and I wanted to bring the right people onto the project. I wanted to make sure we had just extraordinary talent. So yeah, I just wanted to have my hands in everything.
Well, expanding your horizon here. I mean, look, you know, we've seen some unbelievable careers of folks who have been able to do it from A to Z.
Mm-hmm.
And I really do think the depth that they bring to their projects is really what really puts them over the top, you know?
Yeah.
To have that kind of depth. This picture is unique in that, wow, it's not only about keeping your marriage together under the harshest of circumstances, but you know, the one thing that really I think we always have to remind ourselves of is that it's not just those who are in the military,
mm-hmm.
Who are in the military.
Yeah,
it's the families.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So let's talk about that. Let's talk about you know, how that resonated with you and what you learned yourself by doing this project.
Yeah, I mean, what I really got some insight into. So I guess for me, the film is really about figuring out how to communicate, which to me is a totally universal thing, and it's something that that my husband went through in our marriage. I really was moved by this story because I was recognizing that these two characters are going through two completely different narratives, and they have no way to actually communicate with one another about it. Or when they try, it falls apart, or you get into the comparison game. Like, well, I can't tell him about how hard it is to take care of these three kids by myself or hold this, like, weeping, wailing mother who just lost her son. I can't tell that story to him because he's basically under fire. You know, his story, like, you can't play the comparison. How could he possibly recognize my pain as something worthy when his is seemingly so much more intense?
So before we get too far ahead of ourselves, tell us, give me the elevator pitch on what the movie's about.
Yeah, it's about a couple, Darren and Heather Turner, who feel called to the military. Specifically, Darren feels called to reaching out to the young men and women on the field in the war zone to help them to keep their marriages and their families together. Because what he had kept learning about was that so many of these guys came back, had PTSD, didn't know how to talk to their families, their marriages would fall apart, their families would fall apart, and then they would fall apart even worse than the trauma that they had brought home.
And he's a chaplain.
Right. So he and Heather together felt this calling to go into this world to love on that community and help that community stay connected to their families while they were overseas. And she does the same thing because she's part of the readiness group where she is the first person at the door after someone's informed by a chaplain that their loved one has passed. And she has to pick up the pieces of all of these other families as well while holding the burden and the fear of something happening to her husband while also running the whole household and three children by herself. So, they're both carrying a great deal. So anyway, so it's a story about these two going out into this world to love on this community and try to help these families stay together. Darren does an incredible job of meeting people, meeting their needs and helping families stick together. But what happens is he gets so traumatized by the experience that he comes home and finds himself in the same position with his wife that a lot of these guys had struggled with. He comes back with PTSD, comes back with a lot of rage, a lot of anger, to the point that he gets scary and she has to kick him out of the house and tell him he needs to go get help and that she can't be the one to do it. Mm. So, and then it becomes a story about asking for help when you need it, doing the work of what it takes to fight for your marriage, and finding hope at the end of a very long, dark, horrible, sad tunnel.
And this is a real story.
It's a true story. And both Heather and Darren, they take their story around to bases. He's still active in the military, and they share their story with military families and military couples to offer counsel and offer a story of hope. A lot of these families feel a lot of despair. So that's really a story. It's beautiful and hard and intense and honest and
So what's it like playing somebody who is for real?
I think that her story is so, there's something so universal about it that I didn't get too hung up on needing to be exactly her. You know, we took some liberties with the story a little bit, mostly really sticking very, very strongly to their story. But there is a sense of wanting very much to do great justice to a story that has been so foundational for this couple, that has become a piece of their identity that they get to use out in the world continually. And you want to, when you're telling that piece of their identity, you want to do it justice. You want to do it well. And so there's a heightened level of, you know, of just desire to do it well and to do justice to it.
What is the one role that you wish, that you hope, that you pray, that you think about, that you think, wow, I know when I do this role, when I play this character, I know I'm going to be filled up. I'm going to be fulfilled.
Oh, that's a really tough question. I find fulfillment everywhere I go. I mean, I would say that... every role I've played, whenever I enter into a character's journey, you have to enter into a character that you're playing with unconditional love. Doesn't matter if they're a villain, doesn't matter how like broken and messed up and flawed they are, you have to enter into it in a space of unconditional love, because there's no way that you can play their actions with authenticity if you can't understand why they made the decision that they made, or if you're judging the decision that they're making. So when I enter into a new character and find that unconditional love for them, there is a growth of empathy that happens in my spirit every time I play a role that allows me to see the world through somebody else's eyes and someone else's experience, which fills me up, because it enables me to then go out into the world and recognize pieces of all of these different characters in someone that I might have judged before, or in an action that I might have judged before. Instead, I can go, okay, what's the story there? What is causing this action? It's probably pain. It's probably some kind of pain. And I know that because I just played that over there, you know? So, I mean, you ask... Yeah, I've had a lot of questions in some of the meetings I've been taking lately, like what's your goal? What do you want to do next? And you know, my dream, but it's just a fun dream. I wouldn't say it's as like deeply spiritual as a big like soul filling up thing, but I want to go do something like The Marvelous Mrs. Maisel. Something funny and bright and joyous and well-written and period piece, and something that brings delight. You know, I think there's so much sorrow in the world, and a lot of pain in the world, and I want to tell stories of hope, redemption, delight.
Well, it certainly is interesting. I mean, I have let me see what I have: Hulu, Netflix, Amazon Prime.
Yeah, all the things.
Oh gosh, what else do I got? I can't remember. I've got so much stuff. But there, and by the way, I'm a guy. I watch guys getting their fingers chopped off, and
oh, yeah, all that.
You know, what is it? The one, the drug cartel things, and
oh yeah.
Of course, it all started
Narco.
With, yeah, Narco.
Yeah,
Narcos.
My husband loves that one.
I think all guys love these. It all started with years ago with 24.
You know. Oh yeah. Oh, totally.
But there's so much daggone darkness on these things.
Yeah.
You just think, oh my. Now, I'll tell you, Blue Bloods, that's a great show.
I've heard it's great.
You've
got
to figure out a way to get on that show.
Okay.
I'm telling you right
now.
No, there's a redemptive value to every episode. There's just something where you think, and it's about family, you know. And I love TV like that. I love a lot of different things, but you really think about the kind of the missing elements of what, at this point, what are not on these streaming services, and you think there's a lot of opportunity.
Well, there's an audience that's starving, that's really hungry, and would tune in for.
I think they're all watching the Hallmark Channel.
Inspiring, yeah, but they want to watch things like I Can Only Imagine and Indivisible, like that is a that, and that's an audience that a lot of these. these executives are trying to tap into and trying to figure out how to tap into. So I think, yeah, I and especially with the, I mean, there's just so much content. There's so many places where you can watch TV series now. You're not just network. You're not just cable. You're now in a million different streaming things. So, you know, and there's a massive audience in our country that's like, doesn't want to watch all of the like shoot 'em up stuff and wants like another Parenthood or Friday Night Lights.
You're so fortunate. You've got so many years in front of you. You know, when I got in this business, there were three networks.
Yeah.
And a PBS station. And in a few markets, you had independent stations. But I know when I first got in a TV business, I was a producer. I could put a pickle on a test pattern and get a 30 share. I'm sure you don't even know what a test pattern is.
I don't even know what that means. Don't even know what that means.
Like putting a pickle on a blank screen, yeah, doing little tricks.
Right.
And people would tune in.
And people would tune in.
What else
yes,
did they have to watch?
Right. But now it's like, well, I'll watch 30 seconds of that.
I think this year there were something like 500
is what
scripted
I heard.
Series.
Yeah, 500.
And there still isn't anything
wild.
On.
It's wild.
No, I will tell you, I think what's really interesting here is that you have decided to branch out beyond an actress behind the scenes. And I think it's really a good time to do that because there is something coming. I can't tell you what it is, but I know it's coming. And I know on the radio side it's coming because radio is going to evaporate into air in the next few years. The podcasts are taking over the planet.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Because why is that? They're very niche-y. You know, you listen to what you want to listen to when you want to listen. It's like Netflix for the ears.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Right?
Right.
Because we want to listen. We want to watch and listen on our terms.
Yeah.
Not have some network tell us we got to do this or DVR it or what. I don't even know what a DVR is.
Yeah,
anymore.
I don't even know what network anything is on because I watch it all on Hulu, you know.
But you know what's really cool? It's all about great storytelling.
Yeah. I agree.
So if you as a young woman and an executive and a, you know, a storyteller and also an actress, by the way, but if you embrace that opportunity in the years to come, you are going to be able to tell some amazing stories.
That's the hope. That's really the hope. I started directing this year also.
You did? What did you
direct? Yeah, I directed six little webisodes for Grey's Anatomy. So we did it with our Grey's Anatomy actors, and they were six little 2.5-minute webisodes.
Are you in the DGA now?
Days. No, because it's web, so it doesn't count as the same thing. I think you have to have a certain amount of minutes in order to get into the DGA if it's on web. But it was a really amazing experience, and I was inspired to learn how to direct from working on Indivisible because I got to wear the headphones and talk to the actors and have opinions about wardrobe and have opinions about script stuff and think about the vision of it. And you know, what was amazing is that David Evans, who directed, was so collaborative and welcomed my input with open arms. And so we really got to do it together in a really collaborative way, which was so cool. And I got to witness all the pieces, see all the pieces. And I realized that I had a head for it. Like, I could keep all of the elements in my head. I could keep this person's journey and map it out and know exactly where they were in the script while also thinking about what I was doing in the scene. And I could think about all of those different pieces. And then I had a lot of fun after the fact in post and doing notes for that and suggesting music for that. And so, like, all of those elements, I came back to Grey's Anatomy, actually, this season and asked Debbie Allen, who is the one who hires all of the directors. I said, can I shadow? And she let me shadow. And then she offered me these six little webisodes, which I shot. So I got to shadow twice and shoot these little webisodes. So it's really just a matter of finding the right story that I would jump into an executive producer gig tomorrow. Like, I can do that. I know I can do that. Directing, I think I need a little more training before I dive right in. I think I want to shadow a couple more times. And or or work very, very closely with a DP who is super well-versed in all the camera stuff. Because that's the element. I can go at something from a story perspective. I can go at something from, like, the way I want something to look and feel and the relationships and the acting. Like, I can do all that stuff. But the finding the cool camera stuff and making the transitions between scenes and finding the neat shot that actually ties into the vision, that's something I still have a lot to learn.
Well, I can tell you, I've been in the DGA since 1987, and it's all about the team.
Yeah,
you get a great DP, and you get a great team around you, and
you just go.
Yeah, and you just go. Yeah. You know, and the adrenaline just like takes over.
Yeah.
Your character in Grey's Anatomy, there was no doubt you were playing a woman of faith,
mm-hmm.
right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Which is kind of unique these days in primetime television.
Oh,
right?
Yeah.
Now, is that something that you sort of built into the role, or did it come that way? Or
no, I played the role for 3 years, season 6, 7, and 8. They didn't reveal my character's faith until the end of season 8.
Mm-hmm.
So I was just... And a lot of what happens on that show, they bring in new characters and they try different things and they put people with different people and they kind of see what sparkles and what comes out. They get a feel for who you are. That's just kind of the nature of television. I don't know. I've always been open about my faith, but I don't know that it was me being a person of faith that inspired the creation of April being a person of faith. I know our head of the writer's room got really excited about telling us, he's Catholic, and he got really excited about telling a story about a person of faith. And then Shonda, once they made that decision, Shonda was like, look, the thing I care about most is telling this story with authenticity. And this is something you know a lot about. So the door's open. Please come in, give us your thoughts, pitch us stories. You know, whenever anything doesn't feel right, come tell us and we'll figure it out. We'll work it out and we'll find the right way to tell the story. It's the only thing, that's the main thing I care about, is I want to tell a true story, a very true story. So that was a really neat open door that she gave me, and I walked through it, and I walked through it for 9 years, or actually, I guess, 6 years after the character became or was revealed to be a Christian. And it was an ongoing thing. I had conversations with the writers all the time about, I pitched stories, one of which was told on the show. And I you know, went in and tweaked things here and there. It's like, I would probably say it a little more like this, or can we move in this direction a little bit? And it was a really neat collaborative process. Really, really cool.
But there really is no reason to separate out a Christian role versus, well, let me put it this way. You know, we've kind of got caught up into this thing calling things faith-based movies.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Right? Which drives me crazy.
It makes me nuts, too.
You know, a story is a story.
Right.
And faith is an element of it.
Yeah.
I think it's more from a marketing perspective to let people know, hey, we're raising this flag.
Yeah. Go ahead. Sorry. Finish your thought.
Unfortunately, there are a lot of those flags that shouldn't be raised because they're just bad stories. Hello.
Yes.
Let's take I Can Only Imagine, which has been a mega hit this past year and just an amazing story. That really was a story of forgiveness.
Yeah, 100%.
Okay, you can call it a faith-based story. But
it wasn't. It was a story about the way a song was created through a story of redemption,
mm-hmm.
and forgiveness, mm-hmm. a father-son relationship. You know, mm-hmm. that's what that story was, and the backdrop for it and the vehicle through which that forgiveness happened was through somebody's faith journey, because they happened to be, well, one of them happened to be a person of faith, and then the other one became a person of faith. But I agree. I don't think that was a quote-unquote faith-based movie. I think it was, as you say, a great story about forgiveness and redemption.
I mean, we just love to slap labels on things.
I know.
What is it like when people, and I'm sure you get, you know, what is it like when people, whoever these people are, I always like the people, who are these people?
The people.
Slap she's a Christian on you. I mean, does that ever come across? Do they ever say, don't say the F word in front of her?
No, I mean, I think I might have experienced that a little bit more earlier in my career when I was first I mean, walking into Hollywood as a very sheltered daughter, pastor's kid, I was startling, to say the least, in a very beautiful way and in an heart-expanding kind of way, but startling. It was just a whole, like, seeing people from a whole new perspective. And I think that I was a little like deer in headlights. And so probably early in my career, I had more of those kinds of comments of like, oh, don't be careful what you say. But that's not present. That hasn't been present for a decade at least in my life. I just live, people, it comes up. My faith comes up. But I have mostly, with a few very rare exceptions, been mostly totally embraced. I think people love, like, especially artists love people who are passionate about something, you know? And this happens to be something that I'm passionate about. But it's not ever in an in-your-face kind of slam you over the head or demand that you believe the same thing that I do. That's, I don't subscribe to that kind of way of communicating about my faith at all.
So what did you, first of all, from one preacher's kid to another.
Yeah.
Plus, last week I had Matthew West, and he's a preacher's kid.
Yeah, there you go.
And his dad is part of his thing. We had to share PK stories.
Yeah.
That we've never shared before.
Oh,
so
PK
now it's your
stories.
Turn. I want a PK story. Reach back a few years.
Yeah. You know, like, my PK stories are, I think my parents did it so well. Like, I remember when we lived in the parsonage next to the church on Long Island, and I remember feeling pressure from church members to go to, like, Sunday school and to go to all the Christian youth things. And I didn't want to go because I oftentimes would go and, like, if we were playing a Bible game, kids would be like, well, she can't be in the game because she's the pastor's kid. So she obviously knows all the answers, you know, and it just felt bad. It just felt gross. I didn't, that was not a spiritually edifying situation for me. And my parents read that. They read that on both of us. And they're like, fine, during the Sunday school hour, hang out and have a quiet time or read a book or journal. Like, that's what you do, and then you come to the service. And that's what we care about. You need to come to the service, but you don't need to do Sunday school. And they also, I remember them having a big argument, because we used to have dinners where I think my dad would try to get us to memorize scripture, and we got really frustrated with it. And my mom said to him, do you want them to grow up and know scripture and hate it? Or do you want them to not know it so well, but actually love it and want to know more about it? And he was like, yeah, you're probably right. Let's not try to hammer it in. And the wonderful thing is, like, my faith really expanded going away to a Christian youth camp where my parents weren't there, where I was able to just be in and amongst people who didn't know I was a pastor's kid. And we were all doing the cool thing, which was the hanging out and singing the songs and learning about Jesus and stuff like that. So it was, I think they did it right. They really did it right. There was no expectation of perfection.
So when you decided to come to Hollywood, did you come as a single woman?
No, I was married already.
Oh, you were married. Okay.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
All right. So I guess your parents felt a little bit better about that then.
They've been 1,000% supportive since I was 5 years old.
Okay. So they were
drove me to auditions. I had acting classes. I was working with a manager when I was in middle school.
They wanted you out of the house.
No, you know what? This was always the quote that we always came back to when talking about it, is that Chariots of Fire, the conversation that Eric Little has with his sister when she says she wants him to come to China and not run this thing and whatever. And he said, but when I run, I feel God's pleasure. So, like, I could go be a missionary, but actually I'm feeling God's pleasure while I'm running. Like, that's, he made me fast. That's what he made me to do. And my parents and I always talked about this as, like, a very specific gift and calling on my life, and that he'd gifted me in this way to use. So my parents were 1,000%, have always been 1,000% behind me in this pursuit, for sure.
But you came to Hollywood with your husband.
Yeah.
And what's he do?
He's a professor.
Wow.
He teaches comparative religion.
Really?
Yeah, at Occidental right now. He was teaching at UCLA, and now he's at Occidental.
Very cool.
Yeah. So he teaches, like, he knows a lot about ancient Judaism, early Christianity. He teaches about apocalypticism. So he just finished a course on the history of the end of the world, where he goes through all these different apocalyptic narratives throughout all of history. And it's really cool. He's a smart dude.
I see the two of you getting together and coming up with a script at
some point. I know,
I
right?
Feel it.
I know. It would be very cool, actually.
Well, Sarah, it's been such a delight having you. It's been wonderful.
Thanks so much for having me. It's been great to chat.
Absolutely. And I wish you much success. I know that you're going to have another primetime series here again soon. I just know it. And the best of fortune for you and the rest of the cast for Indivisible.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate it.
Well, there you have it, Sarah Drew, wonderful actress. Look forward to seeing her in her new movie, Indivisible, which is just about to hit theaters.
Yes, it's coming very, very soon. You like the movie. Great cast, great story, can change people's lives. We said it earlier, part of the problem of the main character is he was torn between
now you want me to sing. Torn between two lovers.
You know, I knew you were going to go there, David.
I just can't help myself.
There's times that I tee you up to say something brilliant, and then one of your great songs comes out.
Great songs.
But he was torn between the obligation that he felt to the Army and the responsibility to his wife and children.
Mm-hmm.
And for a while, he lost the battle. Did you catch the play on words?
Yes.
Because he was in the battle, fighting the battle, but he was losing the battle because he was losing his family.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So is it possible, David Sams, that even though you're torn, to be able to multitask and do well at several things at once? Please tell me.
Well, I think that, if I look back on my life, I gave so much of my life away to who I thought I was all about. I was wrapped up in my profession.
Your success.
And my success and being a producer. And obviously I had my eye on that ball, but not on my relationship ball.
Right.
And the biggest lesson you can learn is don't do that or you're going to lose your marriage, which is what happened to me. I just was not giving her what she needed. And the rest is history. I look how I was torn, but unfortunately for me, it was not ripped in half until it was too late.
Yes.
You know, I didn't realize it until it was too late.
But you're not alone. So that's the interesting thing about your story,
mm-hmm.
is that if you think about that 60% or above of marriages in America end in divorce.
Mm.
Okay. So divorce, as we've said on our show before, is divided force. So what happens so often in our lives is that we chase the shiny object. The shiny object for you was the entertainment business.
Mm-hmm.
The shiny object for me was that I would speak, motivate, and people would clap for me. I would go home and she would ask me to take out the trash. I think I want the applause.
Right. I got it.
Yeah. So that
happens. In my case, I was going home and changing diapers.
Yeah.
You know.
So I think that, you know, all of you that are listening right now, you're torn.
Yeah.
As a life coach, I will tell you right now, you have your physical life,
yeah.
your spiritual life,
mm-hmm.
your family life, your job, your finances, okay? So you have all these areas of your life that you're supposed to prosper in all these areas of your life.
But so how do you find that balance, you know, because okay, I've got a new outlook on life, okay? You've given that to me.
Yes.
And the life coaching we do here, I've learned some things that I've implemented over the last few weeks, and I'm feeling pretty good. I'm feeling really good, as a matter of fact. But how do you keep that balance so you don't fall into the same old rut, the follow the same, you know, bad patterns?
Okay, so everything's a priority. So in the way we think as people who follow faith in God is that God's first. Biblically, then if you're married, your wife is second. And biblically, your children are third. And in what it is, it's like the oxygen mask on the airplane. What mm-hmm. do they say?
Put yours on first.
Put yours on first. So if you don't have a relationship with God right and your relationship with your spouse right, then you can't properly take care of your children correctly.
So you said God first, wife second, children third, but where's the career? Where does the big project that we're doing?
The big project comes fourth, but the big project is the shiny object. Because let's say in the jobs that we get to do, we get to have a lot of fun. Wouldn't you say so?
Yeah, we're the best.
Okay, so when I spoke the other day, I'm not going to lie. It feels good when they give you a standing ovation.
Sure does. Yeah.
I didn't see it coming. All right, so that's a lot different than my son when he's little saying, hey, I need a new backpack from Target. So now maybe it's raining outside, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I'm waiting for a long time as he's walking through Target. That's not it. That's not it. Let's go to another store. Then I got to go to another store, then another store. The shiny object was my speaking, motivating, life coaches, stars, and the clapping. We've all chased the shiny object because the other thing did not seem so fancy. And so it's about priorities. But I do believe that God can give you a grace to show you what's important. That's what I have in my life right now.
Mm.
So I have an 87-year-old mother, and I have grace on me to take my time to listen to her stories for a long time, take her to her doctor's appointments. It's interesting, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
I meet with my daughter every week because she's older now. And I don't miss.
Yeah.
I have these daughter date nights, and I don't miss. I'm always around my son. I don't miss. I have grace for it. I think before I try to do it on my own.
Well, there isn't a trip that goes by that if I'm in the area where my kids are, and you know they both go to college, they both have busy schedules. But by golly, I'm gonna pick up the phone. I'm gonna call them. I'm gonna reach out to them. I'm gonna schedule a dinner date with them. There's no way that I'm gonna be in their 30-mile zone, right? And not at least call them and say I'm thinking of you. And hey, you want to get together?
Can I tell you something? I've watched you do it.
Yeah.
Me and you have been sitting at lunch, and one of your daughters calls, and you say, "Excuse me, it's my daughter."
Mm-hmm.
But you got excited.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I'm real excited today because my daughter, she was going to school in one of my daughters was going to school in Boston.
Yeah.
She just moved back here and she's going to school now here.
I love it.
She just decided to do her school here, and so now I have both daughters here in Southern California doing their schooling. So
I feel like Southern California is calling you a little closer, Mr. David Sams, so you could be closer to me.
You know, I lived out here for quite some time.
I know that.
And then I moved to Tennessee.
Yep.
Where there is no state income tax.
Fresh air.
And the people are wonderful. The traffic is a lot better than LA, although it's getting worse. But you know the thing I really love most about Tennessee? That I just don't get in LA.
Tell
you know
me.
What it is?
Tell me.
The humidity, it's great on my skin.
Whoa. You are so selfish today. David, me and you have been friends a long time. I did not expect that out of you. You little bragger.
Gosh, you didn't I?
Yeah, because your skin is glowing, and yet you got to brag about it.
Oh my goodness. We have so much fun here. You're listening to CIA Contagious Influencers of America.
You're changing lives on purpose.
Where I get Tim Storey to blush.
Yeah. A chocolate guy just blushed. Can I say something about my app? I got an app.
Yeah, go for
it. So it's an utmost living app where we're teaching you to live an utmost life. A lot of the motivation that I'm giving to you and life coaching we have on our app, it's only $1.99. Is that high?
No, that's a great price. And it's one time $1.99, right?
One time?
Or do you charge people daily?
No. $1.99 for so many hours of content that I got exhausted.
So less than a cup of coffee at Starbucks.
Right.
You can have Tim Storey in your life every day.
Yes.
Via your phone.
And I know it's good because it's selling like hotcakes, as they say.
Wow.
It's selling. That's good, right?
I've never understood that phrase, selling like hotcakes. I mean, who came up with that? I guess the hotcakes guy.
Chubby people did.
Oh, and also, I you know what? I want to give a shout out right now. Tim Storey has a special going on right now, for the next 24 hours.
That's right.
And it is, you can be life coached by Tim Storey.
Yes.
You can sign up for the next 24 hours and you can have him come into your living room via computer, via your phone, whatever it is you need to do.
Yep.
Now, of course, he can't do it in the next 24 hours. It's sometime off in the near future because you got to schedule these things.
Yeah, schedule it.
But how do they find out how they can have you as their personal life coach?
Okay, so you know I life coach entertainers since the early 90s. What my team and I decided about a year ago, let's open it up to people who just want to change. And holy schmoly, the floodgates opened. So I life coach people. So all you have to do is go to timstorey.com. TimStorey.com. We make it very affordable. And I life coach people through Zoom, through Skype. We also do big webinars, also power calls with people. We're changing lives, David. I'm trying to tell you, out of the people I life coach, probably 70% of them in at least one session, they start crying.
Wow.
You know why? Because they're living a discount version of themselves. And I'm going to help you get back on track and stay with your purpose. That's what I do. That's my gift.
How does it make you feel that you have the power to make people to cry? I'm just leaving you speechless today.
You made me blush again.
All righty, let's wrap this one up. This has been CIA Contagious Influencers of America with David Sams and Tim Storey. That's Storey with an E. I just wanted to make that known again. And I want to encourage all of you to share this podcast. Don't keep it to yourself. Don't keep it to yourselves. It is something that we are doing to help give you tools for your toolbox to go out there and live the life that God intended you to live. You can download this for free on Apple Podcasts, on Google Podcasts, on YouTube, and now on iHeartRadio. So please do go out there and share it.
Here's what I like to say is that make sure if you feel like you're being pulled and you have failed in certain areas in your priorities, ask God to help you. He is a faithful Father. He does not treat us as our sins deserve, for he knows our frame. God knows what you're going through. God will be there for you, and God will grace you. God will grace you for the calling that he's put on your life.
And for heaven's sakes, don't do what I did for so many years. I lived my life in black and white. It was what it was. I lived by so many rules that I just realized, you know what? God didn't come up with all these rules. Man came up with all these crazy rules. We have a few things to live by that God tells us to live by, but all the rest, I mean, you see all the laws and everything we have now. I mean, oh my gosh, who comes up with this stuff?
You know what you are? You're living in color.
I'm living in living color. It is, it is just so much more fun to open my eyes and see the sky is blue and the grass is green, and to have you sitting across from me making me laugh and smile.
And I don't know if I've said this to you recently, but your face is glowing. It's radiant.
You have mentioned that to me several times in this podcast. All right, we're out of here. We'll see you next week.
Life is good.
Life is great.